Hello, nice to see you again. Welcome to this edition of Grace Community Church Online. I'm Pastor David Graham. Our church is located in Boulder City, Nevada. And if you are listening, and I hope you enjoy the visual images and the music, as well as the teaching that we're going to have. Well, we'll begin with a prayer. Shall we do that? Father, we ask your blessing upon our time together. Speak to our hearts. Encourage us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have at least one announcement. On July 18th, we have a board meeting. And if you're involved in Country Store, you might want to be there because we're going to be discussing a few changes in how we organize Country Store. That's July 18th at 1 p.m., either in the social room or the dining room at Grace Community Church.
Please join me in singing, "In the Morning When I Rise, Give Me Jesus." In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all the rest, give me Jesus. Dark midnight was my cry, dark midnight was my cry. Dark midnight was my cry, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all the rest, give me Jesus. And when I want to sing, and when I want to sing, and when I want to sing, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all the rest, give me Jesus. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all the rest, give me Jesus. Please join with me in singing "Soon and Very Soon." Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah! Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! We are going to see the King. The King, hallelujah, no more crying there. We are going to see the King, hallelujah, hallelujah, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King, no more dying there. We are going to see the King, no more dying. See the King, hallelujah, hallelujah, we are going to see the King. Notes done very soon, we are going to see the King, hallelujah, soon.
Requests. My first one is a little girl named Summer. She's part of our Sunday school. She's the granddaughter of Deb Stolpe. She had lost a lot of weight, and she's very skinny, and they discovered she has a very serious case of Crohn's disease. They're trying to figure out what they can do to help her. It's she needs divine intervention and prayer. And so let's ask God's blessing for her. Also, Shirley Fletcher has been in the hospital, and, you know, she is nearly blind in our church, and she has pneumonia, and she is at Henderson Hospital, and yesterday when I saw her, she's getting a little better. She's eating food, and maybe today they'll bring her over to rehab at Boulder City Hospital. That's what we're hoping, but she needs our prayers. Carl Murphy Framke has a testimony of a blessing. As you know, he's been bleeding internally, but nobody could find it. And his blood count when he first went into the hospital was at 6. At 5, that's you can't survive if your blood count goes down to 5. They gave him 3 transfusions and brought it up to 9, but it should be about 15 to 16. But on his last test, they said, "We don't know why, but your blood count is back in healthy range." And so I don't know what the numbers actually are, but he left for Ohio yesterday. So that's a miracle, and it's because of prayers. So that's a praise for Carl Murphy Framke. Now would you join me in prayer for Summer and Shirley? Lord, we bring to you, first of all, Summer, Lord. We ask that you would touch her and heal her in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we bring Shirley Fletcher to you. We ask that you would touch her and heal her in the name of Jesus, Lord. We thank and praise you for your faithfulness. Lord, we ask your blessing upon all those who are suffering illness. And Lord, for those who are grieving loss, I pray that you would bring comfort and peace in Jesus' name. Thank you for being aware of all of us at all times. Thank you for who you are, Lord, the Lord of heaven and earth. Now we pray the prayer you taught your first disciples. Let's begin. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive those our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and your answer will be yes, Lord, yes.
Our scripture reading in the Old Testament is from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. Moses and the burning bush. One day Moses was tending the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro. He was the priest of Midian. He led the flock far into the wilderness and came to Sinai, the mountain of God. There, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the middle of a bush. Moses stared in amazement. Though the bush was engulfed in flame, it didn't burn up. "This is amazing," Moses said to himself. "Why isn't that bush burning up? I got to go see this." When the Lord saw Moses coming to take a closer look, God called to him from the middle of the bush, "Moses, Moses." "Here I am," replied Moses. "Do not come any closer," the Lord warned. "Take off your sandals, for you are standing on holy ground. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." When Moses heard this, he covered his face because he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord God told him, "I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their cries of distress. Yes, I'm aware of their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and lead them out of Egypt into their own fertile and spacious land is a land flowing with milk and honey, the land where the Canaanites, Hivites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, and Jebusites now live. Look, the cry of the people of Israel has reached me, and I have seen how harshly the Egyptians abused them. Now go, for I am sending you to Pharaoh. You must lead my people, Israel, out of Egypt. And now for the New Testament reading, Acts chapter 6. But as the believers rapidly multiplied, there were rumblings of discontent. The Greek-speaking believers complained about the Hebrew-speaking believers, saying that their widows were being discriminated against in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 called a meeting of all the believers. They said, "We apostles should spend our time teaching the word of God, not running a food program. And so, brothers, select 7 men who are well-respected and are full of the spirit and wisdom, and we will give them this responsibility. Then we apostles can spend our time in prayer and teaching the word." Everyone liked this idea, and they chose the following: Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit; Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas of Antioch. He was an early convert to the Jewish faith. These 7 were presented to the apostles, who prayed for them as they laid their hands on them. So isn't that interesting? Thus ends the reading of the scripture lessons.
Beloved, I lift my heart to you. When all is said and done, you are the cherished one. Beloved, your gift of love became the strength that calls my name. The lonely road I face becomes your path of grace. When I am tempted to believe that I must seek you on my own is when I find myself in wilderness. The sending power of your love always delivers me back home into the arms of your embracing rest. Beloved, your love keeps calling me from beyond eternity. Through silence, word, and song, your promises are strong. Ooh. Ooh. When I am tempted to believe that I must seek you on my own is when I find myself in wilderness. The sending power of your love always delivers me back home into the arms of your embracing rest. Beloved, your love keeps calling me from beyond eternity. Through silence, word, and song, your promises are strong. Beloved, your gift of love became the strength that calls my name. The lonely road I face becomes your path of grace.
Now I would like to share a brief message from Acts chapter 6 and 7. The title of the message is The Early Church, Deacons and Martyrs. You heard me read earlier about the selection of the seven deacons. And so I want to make a few comments about that. The word deacon comes from the Greek word diakonia, and it literally means one who serves. A deacon is one who serves. And so we see the genesis of God's structure of the church, the ecclesia. The word church in Greek is ecclesia, called out from. Those who are called from the world and transferred in to the kingdom of light, into the kingdom of Christ. So these believers were growing by leaps and bounds, and they really cared about each other and they loved each other. And so they began to be called a third race by the Jews. A third race. They were neither, as Paul would write later, they were neither rich nor poor, slave nor free, Jew or Gentile, male or female. The categories which previously divided human beings were being abolished, were being disintegrated in the life of the church, where everyone esteemed and respected each other equally. That's how it should be. And then, of course, we realize then that the early church really had only one simple structure made of two parts. One, elders. They were called bishops, and they were the overseers of the church, literally in Greek, overseer. And those were the elders who would pray and teach the word of God. And then a second layer were the deacons. These were respected men. They didn't teach and preach, but they took care of the administrative functioning of the church. In this case, since there were no social programs, if a woman was a widow and her husband had passed, she had no way to earn income and to buy food so she could eat. And so the church took upon itself this social program of providing daily distribution of food. And here the problem, as we had read earlier, was that the Greek-speaking widows felt that the Hebrew widows were getting treated better. That may have very well been the case, because there seems to be always in our human nature a kind of discriminatory attitude. We are most comfortable around people who are most like us, and we more or less withdraw or distrust or dislike people that think, act, talk, or look different than us. So this is a problem that the Holy Spirit wanted to address in the early church, and he was doing very well with that. So that's the first part. Now we find out that Stephen, this elder who was full of the Holy Spirit, he was a tremendous man. Some of his qualities were that he was a miracle worker. He had great grace and power with God. We know he was trained in Greek philosophy. He was a great debater. He was also highly knowledgeable about Jewish history. He was an effective debater, and he was anointed by the Holy Spirit. Look at verse 15 in chapter 6. His face became as bright as an angel's face. This is when they brought him in to the council. They arrested him because he had been involved in a debate. And I'll give you the reason for his arrest. I'll just read this. One day, some men from the synagogue of freed slaves, as it was called, started to debate with Stephen. Now, these were men who were probably intellectuals. They were Jews from Cyrene, Alexandria, Cilicia, and the province of Asia. And they attended that synagogue, but they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which Stephen spoke. And it made them upset. So they persuaded some men to lie about Stephen, saying, "We heard him blaspheme Moses and even God." And of course, this upset the people, because Moses was a great prophet. And so they arrested him and brought him to the council. And it was while he was in the council, everyone in the high councils were staring at him. Why? Because his face became as bright as an angel's. The anointing of the Spirit of God was heavy upon him. So they ask him, is there any truth to these charges? They were fair. They were going to give him an opportunity to respond. Well, he takes all of chapter 7 to do a complete outline from Abraham on in the Old Testament. And if you don't remember much about the Old Testament, I suggest maybe this week that you would read chapter 7 in the book of Acts. It's kind of a cliff notes of the Old Testament, so to speak, with key ideas. So probably also he was wanting to demonstrate to them that even though he was trained in Greek philosophy, he also was a good Jew and knew the Bible. And so as he's discussing how Abraham had been called out and how Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob came along, and he goes through all of these stories, and we come to verse 37, and here is when he starts making his case in verse 37. Moses himself told the people of Israel, God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. Now, his point is that Jesus Christ is that prophet that Moses was speaking of. So I will quote Deuteronomy 18:15-19. Moses is speaking, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet. Nabi is the Hebrew for prophet, like me from your fellow Israelites. You must listen to him. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell the people everything I command him. I will personally deal with anyone who will not listen to the messages the prophet proclaims on my behalf. So Stephen takes that passage from Deuteronomy, from the words of Moses, whom they highly respected as the greatest Hebrew prophet, who then points to another prophet who would come from them. And his point is that Jesus of Nazareth is that prophet. And then he talks in verse 37, or in verse 38. He talks about Moses on Sinai, that Moses received life-giving words to pass on to us, life-giving words. So we know that Moses, when he was on Mount Sinai, received the law, the Ten Commandments, and then also the Levitical and Deuteronomic laws that he wrote down while he was up on the mountain on two occasions, 40 days each. So the Lord taught him all of this. Interesting, we believe, we don't know for sure, but we think he wrote the Pentateuch, or otherwise known as the first five books of the Bible, the Torah. So he's telling this words of life. Now think about that. Words of life. The law are words of life. Because when we are in obedience to God through our faith in Christ, even in our time, they bring life to us. Abundant life, joy and peace in this life, and then in the life to come, eternal life. Forever and ever, the words of life. But as he's going along, remember, he's speaking under the influence, under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. They're not just his words. And he is not politically correct, because in verse 51, he says, you stubborn people. He's talking to the Sanhedrin, these 70 eminent leaders of the religion of Judaism centered in Jerusalem. You stubborn people. You are heathen at heart and deaf to the truth. Must you forever resist the Holy Spirit? And then he says a few other words. That's what your ancestors did, and so do you. Name one prophet your ancestors didn't persecute. They even killed the ones who predicted the coming of the righteous one, the Messiah whom you betrayed and murdered. Well, now he doesn't mince words. The response to these words, they were infuriated, and they shook with rage. In verse 57, they put their hands over their ears and began shouting. They rushed at Stephen, and they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him to death. They didn't like what they were hearing. Stephen was speaking for God as a prophet. He was telling the truth about what they had done. And they killed him. He was the first martyr. You know, it troubles me. And I don't know why the Lord didn't protect him. Think about it. He was effective. He was a wonderful preacher. He could confound anyone with his knowledge of scriptures. And he could present the case of God. And he was a young man. I don't know why the Lord, except that another passage in scripture says, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. And I've thought about that, that from death comes life. That's what it is for Jesus as he hung on the cross. His life was taken, but in that taking of that life, in his death, life was given to us. Eternal life was shed for us. So there is some mystery there that from death comes life, and evidently was God's plan for Stephen to become the first martyr. There would be others. In fact, you'll find out next week when we get into chapter 8 and following that his death ushered in a tremendous persecution against the church. As they were growing by leaps and bounds, there was this backlash. It was inevitable. And it was devastating for many people. It scattered the church all over the Near East. But that's for next time. Would you pray with me? Father, we do want to hear the words of the prophet you raised up, Jesus, and be obedient to them. Lord, we do want to understand how you organized the church that we are a part of. Help us to gain clarity of insight and understanding that we might walk in your ways, worship and praise you and be obedient to you, doing good works at all times and all ways, in all places. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
The joy of the Lord is my strength. 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 He heals the brokenhearted and they cry no more. He heals the brokenhearted and they cry no more. He heals the brokenhearted and they cry no more. The joy of the Lord is my strength. He gives me living water and I thirst no more. He gives me living water and I thirst no more. He gives me living water and I thirst no more. The joy of the Lord is my strength. God will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in.